Hafidae, and welcome to this series about ancient sites and traditions of Micronesia. These episodes introduce the latest research and discussions about ancient life, history, and cultural traditions all across our diverse region of Micronesia. I hope that you like this series, and I look forward to learning more together. The natural and cultural records of the past have shown how people interacted with their environments through long timescales. In Rota of the Mariana Islands, the archaeological and botanical records have been investigated by María Cruz Berrocal with colleagues.
My name is María Cruz Berrocal, and I am a scientific researcher at the INCIPIT, an institute belonging to CSIC, the research organism in Spain. And so we have been working on the topic of the early European contact in the Pacific since the 16th and 17th centuries. I realized that there was a neglection of this topic in the historiography of the Pacific. And there has been a number of projects going on, but I'm going to focus here on the work that we carried out on Rota, the Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands, in 2022. I am speaking on behalf of my colleagues here. So the historical context for this research is well known, but I am going just to give you some reminders. The Spanish exploration started in the early 16th century, as you know, with Magallanes, and then this Spanish presence increased with the foundation or the launching of the Manila Galleon in 1565, and of course the colonization of the Philippines. And then there were less known attempts to colonization in Vanuatu and in the Solomon Islands. And lastly, the last attempt of the Spanish crown, which were, by then was joined with Portugal, was to colonize Taiwan. So they founded a colony also in the northern part of Taiwan, where we have been working also in the last 13 or 14 years. But I'm not going to focus on that. So this map shows how the Spanish expeditions, but not only Spanish, but also Dutch expeditions in these 16th and 17th centuries were largely everywhere in the Pacific. And they were touching in many different points at many different islands. And so this for sure established a connection and an interaction with the people living on those places. And I hypothesized already some years ago that this had to have an impact on these social formations, on these islands. Many different kinds of impacts, cultural, but most prominently, I was interested in the introduction of new species and new diseases into these places as proxies of these impacts, because archaeologically speaking, it's very difficult to study these issues. So I used these proxies, for example, the potential demographic collapses that these introductions could have caused, to test my hypothesis. And this is also a hypothetical map of what would have happened if the Europeans were introducing these new species and these new things into particular places, but then the local networks of people who were connected with other islands could carry these new species, these new things, these new ideas, and these new diseases into other islands in their networks. So this would mean that the Spanish were touching upon few places, but the impact actually could multiply. And so this is what I call the NOW project that I lead since 2010. And this was my first proposal that I already submitted in this year. And I was hypothesizing about these potential demographic collapses that could have happened. And this is my website, which is already published, but in the making. So we had a first attempt to test this hypothesis working on ALOFI with a German-funded project that I led based in the University of Constance, because ALOFI was an island that was touched by the Dutch in 1616, but afterwards it got depopulated. So it was perfect to test the idea that maybe the demographic collapse produced a very quick drop in the population in this place. So this was a case of direct contact, European contact. But I thought it was not very satisfying in terms of the potential for this hypothesis and for this project to develop. And then in 2020, I decided to shift the focus of the project to Rota in the Mariana Islands. So Rota, you all know, of course, Rota is a relatively small island. So it is interesting from the point of view of archaeology because you can work with the entire island. And the remains from the colonial periods are relatively well known, but very few archaeological information about the contact period was to be gathered. And so the idea, of course, was that the introductions into the Mariana Islands of maize or other plants, commensal species, rats that were, of course, traveling in the ships very early on in the 16th century and onwards, and the disease could have really caused a large impact that we can somehow measure, archaeologically speaking. So I really like this speech that was gathered by Legovian. This speech by a Chamorro leader called Jurao, and he was speaking about the rats and the flies and the mosquitoes that the Spanish had brought and how this had caused disease, and the Spanish should have remained home, no? Of course. So the hypothesis was that Rota is a very good place to measure these indirect impacts of the European presence, because the island was connected to Guam through customary kinship networks. And so this inter-island navigation could have caused the introduction of these many things going on in these two centuries. And a very prominent result of this introduction of diseases and species and animals and commensal species, etc., would have been a demographic loss on the island. So we had some legacy data that we put together before going to Rota. This is the map that we were able to put together, based mostly on the CRM archaeology that had been developed on Rota due to the tourism, the construction of resorts, etc. And so, as you see here, most of the archaeological information was located on the coast. So our strategy was to have a view, so to say, a holistic vision about the archaeological record on the entire island. And we were hypothesizing that the inland parts were very key and were missing from the archaeological record as it was known. So we produced a strategy for sampling, for survey, for archaeological survey, and we decided to let out of our systematic survey the coastal strand because it was already well known. So we were going to focus on the inland. And we had to choose a number of plots to have a statistically significant percentage of the land surveyed. But the sampling is random initially, because we didn't have an idea, a direct idea of Rota. So we have to create, a route for us, a map, for us to begin somewhere, no? So we produce a random sampling of plots, and then we start to follow this map, this route. And so, of course, when we got to Rota, the problems in the survey are important because there are places in which it's really difficult to walk, just not only to archaeologically work, but also to walk. And so you see here the slopes are very pronounced and the vegetation is very dense. So it took us for at least a week until we were able to start to see materials on the surface. And then we were using, initially we were using the satellite images to have an idea, as accurate as possible idea of the island. But then when we were working on Rota, we were using also drones. And drones are really useful. For example, in this case, these are fish traps that we were able to locate due to these drone images. So the results of the survey were interesting, I must say. This is also in the making. Of course, we are still processing the results before we go back to Rota in the summer this year. But as you see here, we found an important number of sites which are located inland. So this indicates, this shows that the population were not necessarily located on the coastal areas, but it was also located inland, and they were potentially intensively using the land inland Rota too. So this is a summary of our results and how the landscape, the archaeological landscape has changed after our work. But we also have a strategy for botanical survey, because the vegetation, as I said, we are interested in the introduction of new plants, but it turns out that the vegetation is also a good proxy for archaeological processes and historical processes in the past, and I will explain this later. So we also produced a random sample of plots to be visited and to be botanically sampled. But we need to create a reference collection too, because here in Europe, the reference collections for tropical or for Pacific plants are not abundant, we could say. And so we need to create our own collection to work with, and to be able to recognize the remains that we recovered from the archaeological record. So this is our colleague, Alex Chevalier, who was working with us on Rota in July in 2022. And so we do two kinds of sampling. On the first hand, we have to do the sampling off-site, because this would give us the idea of the botanical record independently, more or less, from human actions. But we, this is an example of off-site sampling. Apanun, we located this place due to the help of our colleagues in the forestry department on Rota. And so this is the Talahasha area, where we have huge accumulations of sediment. And so this is ideal to do a coring and to reconstruct the vegetation. It turned out that we found archaeological materials here too at the bottom of the sequence. And so this turned to be an on-site sample. We use also dendroscience in terms of tree analysis. So we took some cores from trees because we want to contribute something to the emerging research on dendrochronology in tropical areas. But we also did on-site botanical sampling, because we did archaeological test pits in several places. So here we not only record, of course, the botanical specimens, or we take the samples for the botanical analysis, but we also do the archaeological recording. And so in particular, one of these test pits, the test pit 2 in Taiping Goat, was really, really productive. As you see here, this is the samples that we could collect, the soil samples, and they are very productive in botanical terms. We are still working on this. Taiping Goat is here, is one of these rock shelters in the peninsula at the southern part of the island. And Taiping Goat, this rock shelter in particular, has a very rich and long sequence of occupation. Starting with hearths at the bottom of the sequence. So people were seasonally or temporarily somehow inhabiting this shelter. But then afterwards, there was the abandonment of these hearths, and then the people started to bury the deceased here. So we have two sequences of burial oriented in different ways, so completely different one from the other. But we don't know yet the chronological span that these burials occupy. So we are sending the C14 dates, etc. This is one of the pottery sherds that we discovered potentially associated to the burials. And as you see here in the SEM image in the electronic microscope, we have seen the remains of food. So this is the food crust, what is called food crust, that we can also analyze in botanical terms and be able to determine the food that these people were consuming, probably in association to the burial episode. So one more thing that I'm going to mention here that I mentioned before is the important relationship of the vegetation to the archaeological record. So this is one of the places we visited called As Rosalia. And as you see here, this is the native limestone forest that is to be found currently on Rota. But in As Rosalia, we found archaeological record, very scattered pottery remains close to this area that I was showing in the picture. And in some other spots considered as native forest, we have also seen trees that, for example, breadfruit trees that have to be planted because they reproduce through vegetative growth. So it means that if we are seeing breadfruits here in the midst of the native forest, it means that in the past 5 or 4 or 6 generations ago, an original tree was planted. So these areas classified as native limestone forest are actually anthropicized. And we are seeing this anthropization in a high degree in some of these areas. So maybe this means that we can reconsider what is native forest, not only on Rota, but also on other islands too. But this is a research that we will continue this summer because we will be returning to Rota for 2 months in July and August. And just to finalize, I have to thank these people who were really supportive and really helpful when we were working on Rota in 2022. And this is the team that was working there in 2022. Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us in learning about ancient sites and traditions of Micronesia. If you would like to learn more details, then I encourage you to visit, in person or online, the Micronesian Area Research Center of the University of Guam. Thank you again for watching this program. I hope that you will continue to explore and discover more.